Well, I'm feeling uninspired, like 99% of the time. But isn't that exactly what it's all about? Don't you feel uninspired about 99% of the time? Of course, everybody does. You know, you keep waiting for this great inspiration to hit, and it never seems to hit. And so I say, why should I tape? I'm not all inspired with some, you know, great something to really say out of this inspiration. But this is the same thing that we all face every single day. What do I do? I just don't feel inspired. So this is the genius of the path. The will of the path is, in spite of not being inspired, you just ask the Holy Spirit for inspiration, and you just make an effort. You make an effort. Now, I don't know how anyone does it. I do this by a taping, but it just you can't afford to wait for inspiration to strike. Cannot afford that. So again, success is based on two basic principles. One, staying continually engaged with your spiritual effort, okay? And two, managing your success. And so staying continuously engaged is what we have to do. This is what we have to do, even though we're not inspired. I know we're all waiting for something to show up and inspire me. You know, I'm so uninspired. I'm so tired. You know, I'm tired. My body's aching. I'm uninspired. I don't. What can I do? What can I do? What can I do? This is the condition of all of us. Even if there was a great teacher with us, we might say, oh, I just don't feel, you know, great inspiration right at the moment. What do I do? We recognize that this is the situation that faces us and will face us, has been facing us virtually every day of our life, or every day of our life, what we call life. And we have to battle through it. We have to battle through it. I was thinking, maybe I should just, you know, lie down and go to sleep. I said, no, I've already done that today. Maybe I should just eat. I've already done that today. And maybe I should just work on graphics. That's not going to really inspire me. And right, so you just think, what can I do? What can I do? What can I do? Again, typical day in the life. Typical day in the life. And it's what we make of these typical days in our lives that makes the difference. Because if we just wait around for that one day of inspiration, you know, we may not get anything. That might not be much of a life. So let's use these days where we feel so uninspired to at least attempt some sort of inspiration and get the ball rolling somehow. Have to do it. And we may not know how to do it because we don't feel inspired. I don't feel inspired. I mean, I was in a beautiful place today working. Poetry in brick. And was thinking about the world and all the agitation in the world and troubles in the world. And was asking for some help. I came across this website when I got home from work, something to do with Kenpo, Sul Trim, that sounds right, Trim, Gyamso Rinpoche, T-S-U-L-T-R-A-M, something like that. Kenpo Sultrim Gampo Gyanso Gyanso T-S-O Gyanso Rinpoche. Something like a Tibetan teacher. And he was talking about, he said something about the situation isn't emptiness, it's not appearance, it's appearance emptiness. Appearance emptiness. And I said, well, that's a nice way to look at it. I haven't heard this before. As we're not trying to see emptiness itself, and we're not trying to fixate on appearances, but appearance emptiness. Abide in this appearance emptiness. And I said, these are some good pointers. He gave out some good pointers. And yet then it started to kind of get bogged down in Buddhism, so to speak, of it both did and it didn't. And that's like all teaching, isn't it? It both inspires, and then it also it doesn't inspire because it's conceptual. So we set out in any effort to make some progress on a day on when we feel so uninspired by being grounded in our discipline. And our discipline here is to be severely modest, severely repentant. Okay, this is our discipline. And sit quietly. Sit quietly. And we lay the groundwork for some sort of success and inspiration to come our way by doing this. And every day we try, somehow we drag ourselves into this with an effort of will, actually. I don't know how else to put it. I mean, I could easily just be wanting to sleep, you know, but I say no. Let's see if we can make really great use of this of right now. So again, hands to hands. We're not itching, we're not scratching and rubbing and posturing with our hands and, you know, grabbing our hair and adjusting our glasses or rubbing our eyes or doing all this stuff. We're trying not to sneeze or yawn or like that. We're just staying very simply, kind of quiet and non-reactive. And this provides the basis for success to arise. Success to arise. Inspiration won't arise until we're ready to receive it. This is a fact. If we're not being inspired, it means we're not ready to receive it. So we better work on being ready to receive the inspiration. What does the inspiration mean? It means success. It means wow. So if we're not getting the wow, it's because we're not quite ready for it. We need to practice this quietness, stillness, the sitting, poised with a poised mind. I find that people want explanations that are dualistic. Try to satisfy both truth and lies. Because ultimately, we feel as if that's as far as we can go. And this is a confusion we have. Because how far we can go is healed perception. And technically, you could say that's still. It's still not the fullness of truth. But we don't need to get technical about it. It certainly is not lying. It's certainly not trying to turn lies into truth and then claiming that our arrogance is never existed. It's certainly not that. Okay, so by saying it's not that, that means that that's okay then. But that's not a, and in the mood of repentance, we don't worry about what seems to be a contradiction. And this is something that the Kenpo Sotrum Gyam So Rinpoche pointed out also. He seems to be someone who has this great facility for Tibetan Buddhism. And he points out that the teaching will seem to be superficially contrary. On the surface, it seems to be contrary, like it's the viewpoint that there is no viewpoint. But if you look at it in context with the depth there, it's not contradictory. So in the mood of repentance, we drop the edge of arrogance in our minds, and then the teaching begins to come alive for us. As long as we have the edge of arrogance, it will seem blocked. And then we'll demand, make all these demands on explanation, not realizing that in our arrogance, we refuse to hear the explanation for what it's really saying. Because ultimately, it's pointing that we drop our arrogance and recognize our arrogance is non-causative. Now, the Kenpo also was pointing out, I believe they're talking about that everything is spontaneously arisen, meaning it's causeless. This is something in Tibetan Buddhism that they often, spontaneity, this term, they have these various terms that we're not quite sure, you know, they understand the context of it, but in looking at it, it means without a cause, it's already there, without a cause. It doesn't. So it's self-free. The self meaning cause basically is. This is a very important aspect of realization. Is you reach the ground of being, which means it's spontaneously there. Meaning it's not being caused by anything. So I say it's already there. It's already there. We can say it's already there. And what was it before? No, it's already beforeness. It's already beforeness. It's already prior to. It's already prior to whatever you can say about it. Whatever can be said about it or asked about it. It's already prior to that. It's already prior to causation. Now, of course, this actually bothers our arrogance. We don't really clearly understand the role our arrogance plays. It's what the origin of all trouble. It's our arrogance. So if we don't realize that we're speaking to the arrogance and revealing it, then we'll put the teaching in the wrong context for sure. And then by putting it in the wrong context, we won't understand it. So then we think, well, you need to explain more. I don't understand the explanation. Give me some more explanation. And it's fruitless that way. It's fruitless. So, you know, a real teacher tries to catch you, so to speak, before you fall into that, well, put it into a context that arrogance can accept. Like that, arrogance says, well, I can't quite get that. Put it into a context that is hospitable to arrogance. However spiritual that may sound. Basically, they say, put it into a real spiritual sounding context that is hospitable to arrogance. Because we believe that arrogance is the ground of a new being and is the cause of our experiencing. Which it's not. It's not. It doesn't cause anything. It's empty. It's non-causative in terms of changing the non-causative nature of reality, or the prior to all causation nature of reality. We can't change that. So trying to change the changeless, the zero-dimensional changelessness of pure spaciousness, trying to change that is non-causative. It doesn't produce effects at all. So we don't say that reality is It's prior to causation as a way of speaking of it. And that we cannot find a prior cause of it. You see, this is what we're pointing out, is we must be very careful to realize there isn't some prior cause to reality, something before it. Our arrogance asserting that there's something before, we were prior to reality, is non-causative. It's not true. And the idea, we play this idea out by fixation, thinking that somehow the ground of being, of pure spaciousness, has somehow been crystallized or fixated with things, and that and with the death of that thing, it is liberated from the fixation. This is not true. Pure spaciousness is never fixated. In Tibetan Buddhism, for instance, they will say, it's never born. It's never born. It's never born, and it never dies either. It's never born, it's never fixated, therefore it's also never liberated. Pure spaciousness is not something that is liberated from something else. So we don't have to liberate anything to realize the true nature of the ground of our being. Everything is already, you might say, quote unquote, liberated. It's never born, so it's not truly, I mean, it's never fixated. There's no fixation of pure spaciousness ever taking place, which gets to back to the, there is no inside, there is no outside. There is no inside, there is no outside. So there's no thingness in that way being born. We think of a thing as something that has an inside and outside. That never takes place, actually, in terms of pure spaciousness. Now, appearance cannot fixate on itself, actually. So ultimately, there's only appearance. There's really nothing at all, technically. There's merely the play of appearance like clouds. There isn't any inside. Now, we're just trying to put our attention on what is truly fruitful, even though we may stumble a little bit here. That's fine. Now, appearances, of course, have an outside. You look at a tree and say, well, the tree stops here. But does spaciousness stop at the boundary of a tree? Or does spaciousness change when it reaches the boundary of the tree? Is there some thingness that is somehow the spaciousness that is permeating within the tree? Is that somehow different than the spaciousness that is outside of the appearance of a tree? Is there some difference? Is there something within the tree that is fixating spaciousness? Or is it just an appearance of particles, actually? So they call all things a phenomena, or you know, what you're seeing, appearances. So again, we're crawling here, being somewhat uninspired, which is exactly what we have to do virtually every day. And we find that by doing this, we do make progress, and we don't lose momentum. Keep the ball rolling. And when we reach, if we're struggling too much, we just back off a little bit. Just use the same approach we always use. Now, I remember when I was young that I was not impressed by what the grown-ups were impressed with. And this used to drive them nuts, and they used to say that this, you need to be educated, you know, this is the, by, so that you will be impressed by what they're impressed with. They're impressed by things. Look at this tree, he said. And I was like, I didn't quite understand. Well, what is it they're looking at that's so impressive in terms of a tree-ness? And so the adults looked at that as you're ignorant or you're childish or you're not understanding, you know, what adults understand. But looking back on it, actually it was the opposite. It was that I had not yet been so contaminated by delusion. So I didn't see the importance in the same way of a treeness that they saw it. So as Jesus says, we need to become like little children to enter the kingdom of heaven. What it just means is you're no longer impressed by the delusion of fixated spaciousness. So when they were looking at all trees, they're saying, look at fixated spaciousness. Isn't this amazing? What an incredible place. And I was saying, I was looking, I said, I don't understand what you mean fixated spaciousness. I'm not feeling any, experiencing any fixated spaciousness. And that was seen as, well, you're kind of a little bit, you're very imaginative and not seeing that, and you need to learn what the adults know. Well, big mistake. Because the training in this world is training in arrogance, in spiritual arrogance. So we can come into this world having divested ourselves of a certain amount of that arrogance in between lives here, and then ultimately we pick it up again here and are very deluded. And yet we're valuing our delusion. We're valuing our delusion because we're on the path of trying to make lies true, which would then excuse our arrogance and saying it wasn't arrogance, it was prophecy. You know, we're prophesizing, we're going to be greater in God, and we feel that we're going to succeed at it. So we think it's not arrogance, and we don't have to repent. This is the world. We come into a very unrepentant world, despite all the surface here in the world. It's an extremely unrepentant place here. So much so that it catches us off guard. And the world tells us you have to be caught off guard. That somehow that's your true nature. To be vulnerable to delusion is your true nature. This is what they assert, because what we're doing here is we believe that we made a deal with God, and that the ultimate reality is up for grabs in terms of a contest. So when we say, well, this is being vulnerable to delusion is your true nature, what we're really saying is this is what we're aiming for, and you need to work towards that. And how can you work towards it if you're not feeling and experiencing it? In other words, you need to get familiar with it. And somehow we think we'll get so familiar with self-delusion that this will triumph over God, triumph over reality. So they say, how can you work on familiarity if you don't start feeling delusion? This is ultimately what they're saying here. And beyond all the arguments, etc., it boils down to just this demand that, you know, there's no way you can succeed and we can triumph over God unless we get familiar with this idea of fixating spaciousness and self-delusion, that we have to get familiar with it. And so I found arguments were useless, because again, familiarity wins. That is the key to success, actually, in terms of hope and feeling that there's a possibility. You know, otherwise we will drop the self-delusion. And what hope does delusion have, except if we just stick with it long enough, somehow magically we will triumph, as if it's a contest in time, that God will finally just can't stand time anymore and will just quit and say, I can't take it anymore, and then we'll win. So he's trying to outlast God. So we've invented something called time. But there is no time, and there's no deal with God. So we're taking a closer look at why do we even go along with this delusion in the first place? And this is this demand. Now, if we see it just as this, not based on any reason, any logic, nothing like that, except we feel we can outlast God, and we need to then get you know, participate in that and help out everyone with that and keep this familiarity going, so we don't drop it, decide, hey, this is too tough. So no, this, we're very familiar, and there's, if we drop it, we'll go into a state of continuity problem, continuity fear. So the you know, I could never understand the reasoning of people there was no reasoning behind it, except this ploy of you need to get just familiar with time, and this will help you win. I said, win what? Well, this world, this mindset here, believes that they're in a contest with God, a duel with divinity, and that the winner gets to determine what's reality, who's the prime creator, and what is real. So this is an aha moment, a wow moment. Why did we surrender? Because the pressure was saying that, you know, they said, well, you can't get it. You'll never get it until you get familiar with it. So because we have used familiarity as the primary tactic to succeeding in defeating God, we're so hooked on familiarity that we have to sort of get free of this hook. And in order to do that, paradoxically, we need to get familiar with dropping familiarity. Familiarity with delusion, self-delusion, really. Familiarity with arrogance. So I always wondered why those people couldn't explain to me why they wanted to, you know, to drop this awareness of spaciousness. Nobody could explain why. But everybody was sure that dropping it was the right move to make, because I had to get started on a path of familiarity with something else. And they say that's the only way you can win. Everybody was sure about that. They didn't question it. And this happens to everyone to some extent here. It's just some are more aware of it than others. Some cave in easily, others really resist it, and such. They have some sort of residual feel and recognition of the resistance and the struggle, and then eventually succumbing, and then asking, why did I succumb? And say, hey, wait a minute, something is wrong about this. Because they don't have any reasoning to it. But what they're saying is, once we defeat God, then we can decide what is arrogant, what is not arrogant. And we can just arrogate that. We say, no, you know, what we are doing is not arrogant. So there isn't any reason behind what we're doing, actually. It's just arrogance. And so, in other words, we feel we'll be able to decide what's a mistake and not a mistake. We're able to make reality any way we want it to be, and we will just simply make it in a way that says we didn't make any mistakes at all. So we feel we don't have to be reasonable when we demand that we, you know, drop reality. We don't have to be reasonable about it. And this is why the world, I asked for, what's the reason I wanted to go? And people got so upset. They said, we don't need to make a reason. We don't need a reason. You know, we're once we win, you know, it's like the victors. We will just rewrite history. We'll decide what is right and what is wrong. We'll decide what is reasonable and not reasonable. Reason is whatever we say it to be. It's going to be whatever we say it to be. So we don't have to even worry about that at all. Why are you worrying about that? You know, that's defeatist. You know, it is defeatism. We're here to compete against God. We're here to defeat God. And so this is the attitude that we come upon in this world, and it's quite astonishing. And then you look for helpers in this world, like help, you know, and rarely do you find them. I mean, even all these teachers that I look at and study, not all, but mostly, for the most part, they still don't bring this up and focus, because the real trauma is losing your awareness of spaciousness, of the ground of being in this world. That's the trauma. And being conned into, pressured into to losing it. Now, of course, we're told that we create our own experiencing and all this and blah, 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 which is ultimately true. But that overlooks the pragmatism of the fact that when you find yourself in this world, you're under enormous pressure. Egoic self-arrogance. You're under the pressure of arrogance to go along with the goal of arrogance, which is to make lies true. You're under enormous pressure. So it's just like if you hang out in bad company, you know what? You're going to probably end up doing bad things. Now, you may, of course, you choose to do that. You animate, you know, you create your own experiencing. But you would not choose to experience in that way if it weren't for the bad company that you were hanging out around, you see. So it's both of those things. It's both of those factors. You cannot just assert, oh yeah, we create our own reality and everything's great. You know, that's it. That's not like that coming here. We're under pressure here. Severe pressure and threatening pressure, claiming that there's, you know, you'll throw everyone to the abyss if you don't go along. You'll allow God to defeat us and the deal we made with God. If God defeats us, then we're going to be annihilated. And, you know, all this complete, you know, terror and dread of annihilation from this imaginary non-existent deal that arrogance believes that it forced upon God. You're under a pressure to go along with the program of making lies true. You're under incredible pressure here. Just is off the charts. So at some point you may just go along with that and then begin to see, oh wait a minute, I don't see the spaciousness. Oh, now I see things, you know. I see just thingness. I'm fixated on thingness. Now this Kenpo Tsul Trim Gyam Tso Rinpoche said, don't fixate on either emptiness or appearance. Let you abide in appearance emptiness. And also he said, abide in clarity awareness. Or clarity emptiness. Clarity emptiness. As your true nature. Or awareness emptiness. Clarity emptiness. Appearance emptiness. Okay. So, by recognizing the pressure that we've been under, where, you know, this fills in the blanks, because just giving someone a teaching, it's rarely enough, because we want to know, why did I, you know, let go of the truth in the first place? And I thought I could come here and hold on to it, and I lost it, or it's so difficult to get it, but we're under incredible pressure. Like we're hanging out with very bad company in this world. And certainly, we know if we've ever hung out with bad company, we know it turns out very badly for us. And then we regret it. Say, how in the world could I have chosen to do these things? And the answer is because we're hanging out with some very mischievous, wicked habit patterns that people were carrying, and they, you know, you ended up wanting to impress them, or feeling if you didn't do that, that something terrible would happen to you. You were under a spell because of bad company, and then you ended up doing things that you regret. Now, it's easy to say, well, you shouldn't be under a spell, but you know, that's like saying, well, everybody should just be enlightened. Because really, if we're not under a spell, we're enlightened. And if it was that easy, everyone should be enlightened, then all it has to do is God to say, hey, you should all be enlightened, and then boom, it should happen, and we wouldn't even be here talking. No one would even be, you know, in this, talking about this at all. It's not like that. We have this continuity fear. We have the fear of the abyss. We're around bad company. We're around those who are still zealously, fanatically pursuing the path of trying to make lies true, so they can claim they were never arrogant. And this knocks us off track, and we end up not abiding in appearance emptiness. Instead, we're trying to find a fixation on either appearance or emptiness. instead of just the natural abidance and appearance emptiness. So of course we don't want to regain that abiding and appearance emptiness and then get knocked off of it again. So that may be why we're trying to fixate on emptiness. You're saying, well, wow, I got knocked off appearance emptiness. I need to, you know, fixate on emptiness. But no, that is not the answer, actually. So if we can recognize why we got pressured off of abiding and appearance emptiness, then we can go back to it and accept it without trying to fixate on either appearance or emptiness. Fixation on emptiness are like the trance states that Buddha said that's not the way. Didn't find the answer there, no. And a fixation on appearance is like the path of mortification of the body. Okay, that's not the way. The middle path might be experiencing the abidance in appearance emptiness. Now, is that middle ground? No. It's not a combination, really, of either. It's not a conceptual combination. It's not conceptual in that way. It's just that when we get pressured to make lies true, we think that there's a deal in place, and that there's emptiness, and then there's appearance, and then there's a deal between the two. This is the root of our arrogance. This is the root of our delusion. There isn't emptiness and there, you know, and then there's and then appearance as two dualistic polarities, and that there's some sort of deal or integration between the two. That is not true. That is non-existent. It's like there's no deal with God. That we never made a deal with God. There is no deal with God whatsoever. So we're closing in on this now, really. So when we shift into deal-making mindset, which is arrogance, then we think there's something called emptiness and something called appearance, and that we can somehow integrate the two. Ultimately, it's a contest. We feel a contest between the two. But anyway, we can then fixate on one or the other and then think that the goal is somehow to that bring them together or unify them. This is not true at all. There's no such thing as a separatedness in reality. But we want to understand it in terms of deal making, which is conceptuality. Conceptuality arises from the belief we made a deal with God. So we need to understand both sides of the deal. There aren't any sides of a non-existent deal. Non-existent deal doesn't have any sides to it. So conceptuality cannot deal with reality. Conceptuality cannot deal with reality. Conceptuality cannot, we cannot make a deal with reality, and therefore there's no arising of conceptuality. Reality doesn't give rise to conceptuality at all. It's our belief that we've made a deal with God that gives rise to conceptuality. And so we recognize that no deals has been made at all. Pure arrogance to suggest that there has been a deal. Okay, now we're into the wow mode, because this is brought up that this is just a very profound place we're at to see this, to recognize it. And avoid trying to say, well, what can we do with this? Don't struggle with how to apply it. Not at this point. At this point, we're just recognizing that we've gotten this far and saying, wow, this is really tremendous. So appreciating that you've gotten this far is really important. That's called managing your success. So we take a deep breath and just... So we realize, well, there's a little more work to do, but before we do that, let's take a look and say, wow, look at what we've really accomplished. Because the work that remains to be done, we really have to approach that with some sort of renewed confidence, you know. And so we have to get to ultimately flipping the script on it, and that requires this capacity to renew our confidence that we can really, you know, be successful at this. Whereas if we just struggle with it, we're going to lose some confidence. So, anytime you're doing something difficult, like rock climbing, you at some point you need to rest and just recognize how far you've come and say, wow, I'm a great rock climber, look at this. And instead of looking at this really difficult pass up ahead, the stretch, the stage, I guess they call it a stage, look at all the stages that you've succeeded. You just sort of look at, not individually, but you look down and you say, way down there is the valley floor. Now you're way up here on this wall, and you say, wow, I'm a heck of a great climber, look what I've done so far. And you sort of build up your feeling of confidence that you're tremendous. And after you've really done that, then you've rested a little while, then you look at this next stage and you say, you know what, I'm sure I can do this. I'm sure I can. I know I can do this. I'm going to do this. You know, and you get this feeling. It says, in fact, in your mind, you say, you know what, it's already done. I know I'm going to succeed. So it's all basically, I've already succeeded. In my mind, the confidence is there, meaning I've already succeeded. Now it's just a question of going through the motions, and you know, and it's like that. So we have to know when to pause, when to pause in the full stop of the wow. You have to manage your path. When to pause, take a pause here. I feel this is the right moment to take a pause. Because I can see ahead, you know, just it becomes so fruitful that, you know, it's just wow. The fruitfulness is... Let's say you're wandering in this garden and you're looking for fruit, and you're finding some fruit on the ground here, you're finding some fruit on the ground there, and you're finding this and saying, I'm finding some fruit, that's pretty good. And then you kind of like go around a little hedge or something in this beautiful lush garden, and through the palm leaves or some leaves, you look and you push them apart a little bit like this, and you're looking through. And you see this like a fruit tree. And the fruit tree is absolutely laden with the most beautiful, luscious fruits, mangoes or something, you know, just oranges, this orange tree. It's just laden, thousands of oranges. And they're all beautifully symmetrical and big and fresh and ripe. And you're just stunned by it. Stunned by the fruitfulness of it. What do you do? Do you remain stunned, or what do you do? You maybe just let go of the bushes for a moment, and they kind of block it off a little bit. And then you look at the fruits you have in your hands, you realize that they came from this tree. They fell off, and maybe they rolled a little distance or something. And you say, wow, I've already got some of these fruits. And then look at those fruits and get used to them. And you say, those are the fruits that come from this tree. And gradually get used to the notion that you're going to then go walk up to this tree and start picking that fruit. But it's a different notion from finding a few oranges on the ground to being able to pick thousands and thousands of oranges, just, you know, huge pile of these gorgeous oranges. The fruitfulness is just a gigantic pile of fruitfulness. So we just kind of had to stop for a moment, gather our confidence. We say, okay, I know I've gone this far. I've gone so far as to actually be able to look at, catch sight of this tree. And so certainly I can go up to the tree. But I'm going to have to gather my nerve for this. Because recognizing why we let go of this abidance and apparent spaciousness, and why we then split into the belief of need to fixate on emptiness, our appearance, and then we split in the two paths, the materialistic path and the spiritual path, and as Buddha pointed out, the taking both those paths, the mortification of the flesh was really part of the path of self-indulgence. The first 30 years or whatever, however many years it was, it was massive self-indulgence of materiality of the body. And that's the path of fixation on appearance, for instance. And then he said, wow, you know, that's not going to solve it. Maybe fixation on emptiness will solve it. And it didn't. Then he said, well, let me go back to appearance and let me try to mortify that. You know, let me make myself ugly and decrepit like death. Let me try to. And they said, no, that's not it either. And then he somehow remembered an experience under some tree or bush, a shrub, a rose shrub or something, and where he was had this feeling of just, it was just right, and he said, ah, that's it, and this is abidance in emptiness appearance, where it's not, this is not conceptually divided into emptiness and appearance, where you need to fixate on either one. So this, much of what we call the spiritual path is just a part of the deal-making fixation that arises. When we believe a deal has been made, then we need to fixate that somehow reality has been divided, you know, into two. And so a lot of the spiritual paths of the world are just like trying to fixate on emptiness, and that is not the answer at all. That's just as delusional as trying to fixate on appearance. And this is what's so baffling, because as you finally capitulate to this arrogance and believe that a deal has been made, and then you have to win the deal, then you say, well, I want to get back to that feeling of bliss that I had, and the world then says, oh yeah, sure, we know how to do that, just, you know, fixate on emptiness. And so you think, okay, and then you try to do that and it doesn't work, and you think, well, there's something wrong with me, I need to maybe spend many lifetimes working on this. Well, no matter how many lifetimes you spend working on it, it doesn't work. Reality is not something you get back to by fixating on emptiness. One side of a deal, you know, saying this side of the deal is better than this side. There isn't any deal. There has never been a split between emptiness and appearance. There isn't any contest at all. This is all just sheer arrogance. So we drop the attempt to fixate on anything. We drop conceptuality, essentially. The I is trying to fixate on emptiness, trying to succeed at enlightenment. The I is trying to reach enlightenment as it sees it, thinking that's enlightenment. No, it's not. So we're bringing to light the very ground of our troubles here. And of course, this is, we recognize the ultimate fruitfulness of this. I try not to think about it. Because that can kind of overwhelm us. We get better to just stay calm about it. Don't keep looking at that orange tree and saying, "Oh wow! We know it's there. Okay, but we need to get familiar with non-familiarity, or get familiar with dropping the belief that familiarity with lies will make them true." And because we're so used to the issue of familiarity, we sort of need to keep it around. So let's get familiar with seeing that it's not true. Getting familiar with not needing familiarity. Because since reality, there's no deal. Reality ultimately is our home. We can't not be familiar with it. So there's no concept of familiarity in reality at all. But because we have arrogantly believed we made a deal with God and we can become greater than God in a contest with God, and thinking that we just get stay with it and get familiar enough with it that somehow it'll magically make lies true, we do have this issue of familiarity, which then brings in the fear of continuity, which is why we go kind of struggle, and we're concerned about this. Everybody is concerned. They may not admit to it, but again, they're trying to be too spiritual. They're trying to be egoically spiritual by fixating on emptiness, which is what we've gotten off of. We've gotten off of it here. We say, no, that's not it. At that point, then you have to, no choice but to recognize, arrogance and your continuity fear and the issue of familiarity. And you begin focusing on that instead of some sort of spiritual attainment. We're not really, attainment will arrive, or attainment will be, we'll relax into attainment once we clarify all of this and recognize how our arrogance has bullied us around, pushed us around. And again, reality is not something to fixate on. And therefore, there's no concepts arising about it. There's no definition of it. We can say it's emptiness appearance, but emptiness appearance still is a conceptual formulation. That's why they say, well, it's both is and it isn't. Whatever you say conceptually about it, the teachers will say, well, it's not that, nor is it the other. And it's also not both. It's not neither, and it's not both. It's not one or the other. It's not neither, and it's not both. They kind of rule out all conceptuality about it. Nor is it an excluded middle. See, it's not an excluded middle. I know Longchamp says cherish the excluded middle, but I think that's maybe a mistranslation. It's not an excluded middle. What's excluding it? Reality is not some middle state. There never was a deal in place. There never was any deal. Now, you can say excluded middle as a concept. You can use that terminology. Maybe it's not a, I said, maybe it's a mistranslation, or maybe we just need to understand, you know, cherish the excluded middle. But this is still from a very conceptual dualistic, that's a standpoint to say that, cherish the excluded middle. It's not a middle at all. There's no middle between truth and lies. There's no deal. There's not some middle of it. Well, okay, this is part from God and this is part from the ego, and we'll cherish that. This is part emptiness and part appearance. No, there's not. It's not like that at all. We cannot conceptualize it. So when they say, well, it's not the excluded middle, nor is it not the excluded middle. It's not, and it, nor is it not. And what they're just doing is getting you off of, these are just tactics to get you off of conceptuality, to frustrate conceptuality. As we try to conceptually pin it down, like, okay, let's pin this excluded middle down. We're still in our conceptual, arrogant deal belief and deal making arrogance there. There's no bridge between the two. There's no real bridge at all. There's no conceptual bridge. That's why it's like a shift. And you say, wait a minute, how did I bridge that? There isn't any bridge. And then we assume, well, there must be a continuity fear. No, there's not really a continuity fear seen correctly. And see, conceptuality believes that enlightenment is some super conceptual condition, and therefore conceptuality somehow has to catch up conceptually to it. And so then it fears this continuity, breaking continuity. It says, wow, how in the world am I going to be able to, you know, conceptualize this as if this is possible? But what we recognize is that there's no possibility of it. It doesn't arise. There's no cause. There's no need. There's no deal. There's no two sides. There's no deal. So it's not a super, super conceptual state. It's not a state of fixation. It's a super fixation. Reality is not a state of super fixation. That's the most that conceptuality can look at. Well, it's some super fixation, but it still feels that it has to somehow account for it. And it feels like it would just have to, it feels then it would have to just use chaos to somehow describe it. Because any conceptualization that has doesn't apply to it. So the only way we can conceptualize reality is actually through chaos. And that's not really conceptualization. We find, we don't want that. So then we reject reality, say, I can't do it, I can't do it. But there isn't any concept. That's still based on our idea of fixation on emptiness as somehow the spiritual answer. The corollary of that is you try to embrace reality and you get chaos. Because any conceptual thing we say about it isn't true. So we think, oh, okay, this isn't it, this isn't it, this isn't it. And so we have just this complete conceptual chaos where we're not able to fixate on any conceptuality at all. And yet the conceptuality is still flying all over the place. You know, we feel chaos. That it's all these thought forms, so to speak, but they're all in a chaotic motion. We're not able to put any pattern onto them, you know. And we think, okay, well, this is what we have to get used to, and this is not true. This is not true. There's nothing to conceptualize about reality. There's nothing about reality that gives rise to conceptualization. Only the arrogant belief in a deal. We've made a deal with reality. That gives rise to conceptualization. So this is very fruitful here. I didn't expect any of this, of course. This is what happens when you make an effort. When you're not inspired, you know, it's just, this is really quite something. Come across this and seeing that the root of chaos, now seeing it, like, oh, wow, now I see it in a much clearer context than ever before. So, again, not to try and forge ahead too fast here, but recognize the success. It's almost sort of like on a rock wall. We have now completed another stage, a seemingly quite difficult stage, but it was easy for us. I mean, most climbers would look at that stage and say, wow, that's like a, I don't know how they number them. That's a 12, or I mean, it's just like a very difficult stage. You know, and most will look at that and say, I can't figure out how to do that. Well, we just did it easily. And so now we look down and look, see how where we've come so far, and just like, wow, that's tremendous. But we're not really looking at the next stage too carefully at this point. We recognize, okay, there's another stage here, and we know we're close to the top of the wall, but we're not really too concerned about the next stage. We're just celebrating, appreciating, and recognizing how far we've come. We just did another tremendous stage right there, but easy. And that's a shock. That's a shock. I mean, I can say I've spent, you know, really, you could say, you know, 48 years, or just, you know, a long time working on all this. Close to 5 decades, really. Let's put it that way. Close to 5 decades, and feeling not being able to get this, and just struggling with it. And if I find this is the most difficult, this is so supremely difficult, I don't know if I'll ever get it. And now I just went through it, and it was like easy. I have some friends and acquaintances and et cetera that were rock climbers, and maybe some of them still are. I mean, they're young, they always used to go rock climbing up to Yosemite, and I said, you're crazy. I mean, I just couldn't fathom how they could do this. And I always thought, you know, gonna get a call, and so they fell, you know, and just so scared. And I got petrified on trying to climb rocks, absolutely petrified. But for them, they just loved it. You know, they said, wow, this is just great. I just could not understand their mindset. But really, what we're doing is like spiritual rock climbing. And I'm sure they get quite petrified, not being able to understand how we can do this, how we can look at chaos like this and recognize, say, oh yeah, I see the context, there's no problem. And they just like, you know, it's just like, oh, I just don't know how you do that. You know, it's just unbelievable. I'm so scary. There's no way I can ever do this. I mean, could I like climb El Capitan? No, you know, no. So they look at it as like spiritual El Capitan. You know, how can anyone climb that? They're thinking. So really, you have to be very good at it, and you do that by being very interested in it, and you do that by being very inspired by those who have done it, and you then make it your business to be able to do it. And failure is not an option. For me, I always put failure out of my mind, as it simply is not an option at all. And I refuse to be around anybody who claims failure is an option. You can't have those thoughts bouncing around your head, failure is an option, when you're doing some real difficult stage like we just did. You have to know that failure is not any option whatsoever. And we have no choice but to succeed here. And so you go at it with that attitude, that no choice but to succeed. And so you take it seriously, and then when you make a successful stage like we just did, you know, you're still serious. So you're full stop in the wow here. We're not struggling with the next stage right now. We're just appreciating the dedication that it took to just do that stage. You know, almost 5 decades of determination to be able to do that stage like that. So respect yourself, respect your path, respect the efforts you're making, because not many people respect them for you. That is for sure. Most people will say, look at you and say, you're crazy. What are you trying to do? Climb that wall? That's insane. You're going to fall. You're going to fall. You're going to fall. Like, I was so nervous, and you know, the other people were climbing. I just didn't understand. I say, it's too dangerous. They don't want me around because that puts negative thoughts in their mind, right? That they might fall. So I didn't go. I didn't hang around. I understood that. So it's the same thing. Those who feel that you're going to fall off the spiritual wall, you know, you don't want to hang around them, because falling is not an option. Failure is not an option. You're on that wall until you succeed, ultimately. This is a fact, though, for everyone. They don't realize that. You're on the wall until you succeed in ultimately climbing to the top of that wall. All those at the bottom of the wall screaming up to others, hey, you're going to fall, you're crazy, you're stupid. That doesn't help them get off the wall at all. They're attached to that wall. Even though they're at the bottom of it, they're still attached to it. They can't get free of it until they finally climb to the top. Ultimately, we're, you know, and recognize the recognition and abidance. Finally, that's the wall of their arrogance. They're attached to it. You don't get free of arrogance by making lies true. You cannot. You cannot. You can't get free of it by just fixating on anything. You cannot. Whether it's emptiness or appearance, you cannot. You cannot do it that way. So, I mean, reaching this recognition of what chaos really is extraordinary for me. That's just, that's big time. And so, we don't want to try to do the next stage too quickly, because at some point this is going to hit me. You know, the wow's going to hit me, and that'll freeze me up. On the next phase, I'll get frozen up on it. So let's first process the wow. If you realize you've made a huge progress, that has to be processed. Has to be processed. Full stop in the wow. Don't immediately plunge into this next real tough stage. You know, once it's all processed, then you'll very clearly look at the next stage, and you'll kind of get this sense like, okay, I've got the tools, I got the moves to do this. I'm very clear about, you know, what this conceptual chaos is about, and how, you know, and then you'll be able to go, you know, to the next stage for sure. Obviously, it will be there. It will be there. And those below are screaming, okay, but how's that help you fixate? You got the answer. Now fixate. How do you fixate on emptiness or something? You don't. So you cannot listen to that false spiritual chatter. This doesn't give us a tool to fixate. It gives us a tool to drop fixation, actually. And this is not, see, the benefit of understanding of where what this chaos is about, then. If you don't understand it, you think that Yeah, well, I don't want to struggle with it right now. See, I could feel the struggle right there. I'm not quite ready to do it. When you start moving on a stage, you want to get through it. You don't want to just get freeze up in it. Don't want to freeze up. So if you feel that freeze up struggle, drop the struggle. Say, no. I'm going to just, I got too much wow going on in me right now. Too much wow. As I said, managing the success of your path is the ultimate decider of your success. And taking this break like this, managing the wow, is all important. So don't allow this, oh my gosh, you know, to get going in you. Just remain sober and modest, fairly modest, humble, full stop on the wow. You're not trying to apply it. You're not trying to gauge it too much. You already know. You're feeling the wow. You already know that this is very significant. You don't need to go any further than that. Don't try to measure the significance. Don't try to extrapolate upon it. Don't try to elaborate upon it. You already feel intuitively, you know, the tremendous significance. So just don't take it any further than that. Full stop in the wow of that. Don't anticipate how you might be in a few minutes or the rest of the day. Try not to imagine and anticipate, okay, well, how am I going to feel the rest of the day? What am I going to do with this newfound? You know, don't anticipate any of that. Just let it naturally settle down. I don't know. I'm not going to prejudge the future, as it were, based on this insight that just occurred. I'm not going to prejudge it. I'm just going to leave it open-ended. I'm open-minded about it. I'm not trying to fixate or crystallize what was likely to take place at all. I'm not trying to plan or scheme it, you know, strategize it. Stay strategy-free. How are we doing on the video? Okay, great. We've reached over an hour already. That's pretty good for a not being inspired. For not being inspired, we sure delivered a whopper of a video so far. Now, certainly the fatigue is hitting me so strong these days because the anticipation of how difficult these stages are is probably, you know, causing me a great deal of concern. Just like if you think that there's a couple of stages here to get to the top that are just going to be astronomically difficult, you're going to be stressed out about it. But as we just saw, we just did that stage easily. So, you know, the worry and concern and fatigue is, you know, ultimately unfounded, I would say. Probably, you know, it is ultimately unfounded. But don't quite see that. So we're avoiding patting on ourself on the back too much here. This is just business as usual. We're just making the efforts as usual, and we're getting the success as usual. This just happens to be the latest stage of success we're getting. That's all. I'm going to try and shift the light of this a little bit as it gets darker. Bump up the light as it gets darker, right? Absolutely. You need to bump up the light. The world's getting very dark as this plan, this great new world order to try and make lies true, is gaining stronger and stronger adherence in the world. It's getting very dark, but we need not fixate on that either. We need not apply ourselves to that, to any of that either at this point, actually. So let's drop that. And nor do we want to go back on that stage that we just did and say, well, how did I do that? How did I do that? Because we're allowing, we just want the confidence to build up. We did it. We know we did it. And so that's let our confidence build off of that instead of trying to quibble about details. Now, how exactly did I do that? You know, no, we're in the euphoria, the elation of having done it. So we're not going to try and chip away at that by trying to throw ourselves back into asking, how did we do it? Starting to cool off out here. It's going to be somewhat of a cool evening. I can feel that. The marine layer is going to get stronger. Actually, it's already sort of starting to thicken up a little bit here. There's a strong marine layer in the Bay Area today. Really cooled things off. It's going to be even stronger tonight, it looks like. So remember this sitting here like this in the wow is managing your success. This is ultimately the most important part of your whole spiritual path, is the ability and willingness to do this. It's like when you hit a home run, you have to trot around the bases. That's part of the deal. You got to trot around the bases. And so so again, this is the most important part of the spiritual path. Those insights will never arise. You'll never get them if you're not very good at this part of not struggling, not forging ahead, full stop in the wow of it. Because this is a powerful wow. I don't want to measure it, because that messes things up. But it's obviously. I mean, you know what's been sticking points, you know, in your life, right? And when you suddenly catch a new perspective on a major sticking point like this, you just know it's fruitful. It's super fruitful. It's like seeing that orange tree with covered with fruit. And that's what just happened, actually. Just oh my gosh, I see the orange fruit's covered with fruit. Oh, yeah. At that point, you know you're close. Just say, hey, okay, I'm just going to full stop on the wow of this. I'll normalize it. Again, what's the most important part of your spiritual path, your liberation from delusion, is full stop in the wow, managing your success. That is by far and away the most important aspect. This is the aspect I believe that people overlook. We overlook, we devalue it. We don't practice it. I mean, how many times in a lecture, spiritual lecture, spiritual teaching, how often does the teacher just, you know, stop and say, you know what, we just need to stop right now? If people say, I paid $100 for this ticket, I want to get as much as possible, you know, just stopping right now and taking 15 minutes or whatever and not saying anything or just, you know, talking about the weather or something, that's the most beneficial part of the whole teaching right there. Is showing you this is what you have to do. How often do we get that? I mean, it's very rare. I mean, there are some teachers who say, hey, we just need to, yeah, they're doing it the right way. Now, some teachers, at the end of their satsang, they may have a quiet time, like, okay, we're gonna have an hour quieter now or something. Well, that should be there too, you know, that's fine. But really, it should be, the whole satsang should be punctuated with full stop in the wellness. Absolutely, it should. Otherwise, they're not getting to the wellness of it so much. I mean, you got to punctuate it to a certain extent here and there. And especially if you really, really get into some profound success, hey, let's just stop right here. So always be willing to stop. The key to going fast is the willingness to always have the willingness to stop. Full stop in the wow. Even when you're writing something, you can just stop. Working on graphics, you can just stop. Speaking, you can just stop. Say, that's enough. I feel the wow is so strong. I just need to not go any further in this, not struggle forward anymore right now. Prove to yourself that you can handle this success. You have to prove it to yourself. Nobody can prove it for you. You have to prove it to yourself. So can I function with this new clarity? Can I, you know, everything okay? Can I keep my mind steady, basically steady? Can I not go to extremes? Can I not get fixated here? You know, all of this is full stop in the wild, allowing yourself to get used to it. Certainly when you've just done a very important stage in rock climbing, you don't want to fixate on your success that you just, you know, what you just did, and say, be so fixated on it that ultimately you don't even try the next stage. No, you say, wow, that was great. That was really great. But I need to let this wow die down, because I know there's another stage to go. So I'm not going to try and elaborate too much on this success. Just let it calm down. Let it subside. The cat thinks it sees something to pounce upon. Maybe I need to distract it. Because it does catch birds in that way. So you have this monumental milestone you reach, and what do? As they say in Zen, you, or as I like to extrapolate, twist it, you carry wood and chop water. Yeah, go ahead and just keep carrying wood and chopping water. And of course, they're saying, you know, chop wood and carry water. Just you keep on, you know, tonight, I say, well, we'll eat dinner, and I'm going to watch Madison Bumgarner and Clayton Kershaw hook horns again a little bit. I might watch a little bit, you know, and just let the evening just play out. Try to say, just, you know, stay just normal, the way you normally are. That's all. No fixation, no grandiosity, no super seriousness. You know, you just stay pretty even keel. Just stay even keel. Just full stopped in the wow. Just poised in letting this subside. I understand that this is monumental, and waves are, you know, if there's a pond, there's a lot of chopping waves. Just the whole, this is just rocks, like an earthquake. It's like a spiritual earthquake just happened. And like the Nepal earthquake, I mean, there's landslides all over the place. You know, how do you assess it when it first happens? You don't. First, you just full stop, and it's like, wow, you know, we had an earthquake, which they did predict, by the way. Someone, a scientist, did predict that. Kudos for their good empirical work there. Of carbon dating, digging a trench and carbon dating, and being able to recognize that this area has not slipped for a long time, and the last time it slipped, it was just after an area that went before it, and that area that went before it was 80 years ago, and they do know that about every 80 years, earthquakes do happen. So they said it's very logical that in sequence will be, this area will be next, and will be right about now. And so they hit it right on the head, where it was and when it would happen. That's very good work. Didn't stop it, did it? That's the catch. I mean, so, you know, it's somewhat of a Pyrrhic victory to predict earthquakes. And so again, you know that the area, you know, is just all over the place. There's aftershocks, there's landslides, that there's devastation, that the whole area is in all sorts of issues. And you understand that it's volatile, and but you're going to center yourself and say, okay, you know, it's happened, probably won't have another one for another 80 years. So what do? We get some food and we get some rest. And so we can then, you know, help the recovery. We have to keep on getting our rest and keeping our strength up, and life goes on as best we can. So you stay grounded in the normalcy of your life. So the same thing, the spiritual path, you stay grounded in the normalcy of your life and in the normalcy of your practice. You know you're going to get back to this quite soon, and you'll be successful in getting back to it. You know that you're grounded in that, so you're not frantically thinking, oh my gosh, you know, if I don't struggle for it, I'm going to forget, or I'm, you know, slip. No, we just stay grounded in the normalcy of our practice, the normalcy of our life, the intensity of our practice. We have confidence in that. Just like I'm pretty sure I'm not going to go on a coffee drinking binge, okay, or a Coca-Cola drinking binge. So I'm pretty confident that I'll be able to keep going through the next stage, and I won't be too hyped up. Yeah, I'm pretty confident in that, because I've proven it in the past that I'm able to avoid those sort of temptations for the most part. So, you know, just sort of a basic, you realize what you're basically, you know, you're basically determined, and trust in that. Trust in your discipline. You've already proven to yourself you have it, so just trust in it. And this is the benefit, you know, you have to be able to do that, full stop in the wow. You have to be able to trust your discipline, that you have it. And how do you get it? By proving it to yourself over and over and over again. So the path really builds up momentum to the point you're able to full stop, even when you get this huge spiritual earthquake like this. Even then, you're able to stop. Even then, you're able to maintain your discipline, trust in your discipline. Whereas if you didn't have all that trust, then the wheels would certainly come off. You'd be too overly impressed by it, and you'd be too shocked, and you'd start, you know, the wheels would come off. You'd lose your discipline. You'd say, wow, my gosh, I panic. I don't know what to do with this. This is like one of the greatest insights that's ever been had throughout all history. And, you know, I don't know what to do about it. This is just overwhelming. And, you know, it's on and on and on. You just stay grounded and you trust yourself. You trust your discipline. You trust your spiritual path. You know, so you just say, no, let me just stop, full stop on the wow, and just let this, you know, settle in. That's all. Don't make anything of it. So this is what you can do through continual discipline. Every day you keep working at it, you will develop a trust in yourself, in your discipline. And you'll trust yourself. You'll trust yourself to resolve even these, you know, monumentally important resolutions. You know, you'll trust yourself to do that. And then it will happen. You'll make it happen. Maybe I didn't feel so inspired today because I must have subconsciously realized that the big one, you know, is this big insight is here, the big earthquake is here. And I said, I'm not really feeling like tackling that maybe. And so I said, well, no, you got to do it. So come on, keep going. I mean, it's tough to this full stop in the wild. It's tough. It's tough. Because it's stressful. You get tired. It is discipline, and you feel uninspired because you just have to be full stop in this, you know. So it's not easy. It's easier to be tackling less, you know, more trivial matters and think you're going really fast, you know. But this super difficult stage of getting around this, you know, that's really important. Really important. Major block there. And so I'm going to, you know, the after effects of this are certainly going to be felt. There's no doubt about it. But I know I'll get back on the horse, you know. I know I'll be able to get back to it. And so I will do that. But as it is right now, just have to let it settle down. And again, another prove it to yourself situation. So you're in charge of your own path. You have to prove it to yourself that you can do it. There's no other way than actually doing it on a daily, but keep doing it on a daily basis. Keep proving it to yourself that you can handle the success as it comes. Now, in this earthquake, how can they settle themselves down? Well, they say, you know, the sun is going to rise tomorrow. So I think of that. I know the sun is going to come up tomorrow. You know, the daylight will arrive. Okay. And I know also the night time will come, and I'll be able to sleep. Okay, so that, you know, those two are going to be constants. I know I need to eat, and that's a constant I need to focus on. And I know at least my body's going to continue to move my arms and my legs and breathe. I'll be breathing tomorrow. My mind will be working tomorrow. My eyesight will be working tomorrow. And so start, you know, just keep reminding yourself that all this stuff is still in play and stable, relatively stable for you. And this instability will pass. This will pass. You do recover from earthquakes. You do recover from inner, you know, spiritual earthquakes that really rock your spiritual landscape. You do recover from those. See, right now I'm not sure what my next position is going to be. I'm not really quite sure exactly where am I now that this shift has taken place. Is it, where am I exactly, and how does the next phase really look to me? Because the next stage is not going to look the same as it looked when you were down several stages away. Now that you're really up close to it, you might look at it from a different perspective and say, "Hey, it's not quite what I thought it was. Actually, it's much easier than I thought." So we have to first kind of recognize where we're at now before we really get a clear picture of how to tackle the next stage. And I'm not really sure where I'm at right now with this just a monumental recognition of, you know, I'm not going to dig back into it. It's already happened. So I'll get a clear picture, sort of generally, of where I stand right now. Should be fun. Should be fun. Look forward to it. Looking forward to it. Okay, so I'm probably going to, I guess I'll bring this to an end here. Where are we at? Oh, we're at 140. That's great. I got this far. That's very good. So you gotta have enough interest now where I'm sort of in flipping the script mode. You can feel a slight shift of enthusiasm now where I'm looking forward to seeing, you know, where do I stand right now, really, in the scope of realization, getting a sense of just exactly where I'm standing, and from there, you know, work on flipping the script, which is basically assessing the next stage and saying, hey, you know, building the confidence, saying, yeah, I can do that. Yeah, absolutely. And building it up until the point where you can really be assertive enough to do it. You need to be assertive. You need to be confident. You need to know. Yeah, it's a done deal. I've already done it. I know I've already been successful. I know I've already succeeded at this climb. Absolutely, I have. All this is just in honoring my creativity. Actually, the whole mountain is non-existent. It's never existed. It's been a hallucination. But I'm just honoring my creativity, which we have to do, basically, to have a sense of continuity with our creativity. Because ultimately, our reality is creativity, freedom of creative freedom, absolute creative freedom, and so we need to have a sense of continuity with that by honoring, you know, as we use our creativity to try and deceive ourselves into imaginary contest, deal contest with God. We need to honor our creativity so we feel there's a continuity as we go forward with you know, really experiencing our freedom and our creative freedom. So we imagine that we have to climb this wall. We have to, you know, have this spiritual path. And so we do know we're already sitting in, not even say, abiding in no wallness, you know, no fallingness. If we can't fall, it's impossible. So where's a wall mean? It doesn't really have any meaning at all. We understand that's already true, and we're spiritually aware of this, and yet there's also this honoring our creativity because of our continuity concerns. So we believe that we're, you know, climbing the spiritual wall, and we'll ultimately succeed at that. And the ultimate success is abiding in the realization that there never was any wall. When we can honor this chaos, conceptual chaos, is an expression of our creativity, and look at it just as that. That's all that it is. Mere appearance of our creativity, and realize it has no real function for us other than to honor our creativity. When we can look at it like that, then that's really going to be monumental. See, I'm working on flipping the script already. I'm starting to plot my, you know, so to speak, to see the next stage like that. Yeah, oh, just see that too as creative expression. And just forgive yourself for that, and thank yourself. Say, wow, that's really great creative expression. But don't fixate on it. So you might be saying, you know what, I could have done this any time throughout history. This is doable any place, any time, actually, the way we're looking at it now. This discipline, yeah, I could have always done that. And it's true, absolutely. We can always do this, and so no matter where you find your place, time and place, wherever you realize you can do this, you absolutely can do it. Just have to, you know, manage your success, flip the script, build your confidence back up, be assertive enough to tackle the next stage in this continuity fear, honoring our creativity, and then rest in full stop in the wow of your success until it settles down, flip the script. You know, you can do that. You absolutely can do it. It's just a matter of being determined to do it. It doesn't take a genius to do this. It takes determination. It takes feeling like you got to do it. It's amazing what you feel. You got to do something. What you do. You don't have a choice ultimately in this at all. You know, you can never make lies true. So ultimately, you have to repent. You have to set down arrogance. You have to recognize this. You have to recognize and flip it into. So now it's just simply honoring. You know, our creativity is honor our creativity, and that's all. That's all that's left to do. And honor this chaos, conceptual chaos, as a whole. It's just honor that without trying to find any patterns to honor within it. You see, that don't, you know, you don't get pulled into it. You don't get fixated or pulled into it. You recognize it. Oh, all of this chaos is just this, you know, attempt. I understand it's a very creative attempt. And that's just what it is. Okay, instead of trying to pinpoint. Now, wait a minute. I want to find specific concepts and patterns in there, because then you'll get pulled into the chaos and you'll freak out. So this is remain just in this abidance, clarity, you know, emptiness, appearance, abidance, and emptiness, appearance. Even with this conceptual chaos, you don't try to arrange the chaos at all. You just thank it for as an appearance of your creativity, which helps our continuity fear, which ultimately, again, that's the real problem we have, is our continuity fear. How do we go from what we think is a totally uncreative state to total creativity and freedom? You know, how do we do that? Well, we certainly need to honor our creativity and recognize that our sheer arrogance camouflaging it was just nothing but our creativity. That's all that it was. It was a supremely creative expression to try to camouflage our arrogance. But it's nothing more than that. And just see it as that. So, okay. So we're flipping the script here. I'm not going to dive into more assertiveness right at this point. I feel like, you know, this is heavy enough to let it go at this. And what do we have right now? We have 140-something. I can't quite see that. 148? Yeah, wow, that's pretty good. 148. So, at the time of this video, I don't feel like diving into another assertive wow stage, but you can feel the flipping of the script is already happening. It's already happening in my mind. I'm starting to build my confidence up, right? Say, hey, yeah, I can do this. I can do the next stage. I'm already starting to see it, but it's not quite clear enough yet, you know, to do it. But I'm starting to say, yeah, I can do it. I can do this. Wow, I can. Absolutely. It's going to get. We're going to get it. We're going to get this done. But not quite ready for it yet. So, very great. What prompted that? What was that? Applause of the crow? So, but still, in full stop in the wow and flipping the script, we're not in the assertive phase yet now. So don't judge yourself accordingly. If you're not in the, you know, don't try to say, wait a minute, how come I'm not? No, we're not there yet. We're not there yet. That's why I say it's very important to recognize where are you at in the phases of your practice. Is it the assertive phase? Is it the full stop in the wow phase? Or is it the flipping the script phase? And when you recognize what phase you're in, it takes you out of guilt. You feel centered. You don't feel you're vulnerable to being mocked. to being overly pressured. You feel centered. You say, oh yeah, okay, I'm in this phase. And then you start working on it. And you don't feel failure. If you misidentify the phase you're in, then you start struggling. Then you start feeling like a failure. You say, what's wrong with me? Maybe I can't do this. And you start losing confidence. So to gain confidence, recognize what stage of this practice you're in. Is it assertive phase? Is it full stop in the wow phase? Or is it flipping the script phase? What phase are you in? If you're in the wow phase, you understand why you're being quiet and low-key. If you're in flipping the script phase, you understand while you're building confidence, you're still not quite ready to tackle. And if you're in the assertive phase, you realize you're full bore getting it done. Okay? You realize that that's it. All right? That you're in going for it. You're absolutely going for it. And then you know you're going to go into the wow. You're going to get it, and then the wow is going to arise from that. And so you're recognizing that there's going to be necessity to then full stop in the wowness. That's part of the deal. Okay, very great. That's it. I'm going to stop the catcher here as we have reached, amazing 150. Wonderful. Okay, just stay with it. Just keep identifying, get better and better identifying where you at in this three-phase aspect of spiritual practice, spiritual discipline. Where are you at? Identify it, center within it, and then just work on that, and you will build your confidence for sure. Okay, very great. That's it for this one.